I would not have a slave to till my ground, to carry me, to fan me while I sleep, and tremble when I wake. For all the wealth that sinews bought and sold have ever earned, we have no slaves at home. Why then abroad?
For thousands of years, long before the rise of the Atlantic slave trade, it was enslaved people who built and served great civilizations on every continent. By the time the first European ships reached Africa, slavery in one form or another was already a global institution. Even so, a new phase of slavery was beginning, one that would reshape both the New World and the old.
If you look around the world in the late 18th century, more than three quarters of the people on Earth were in slavery or servitude of one kind or another. I mean, just go left to right across the globe.
And remember, our word slave comes from Slav, and it's because Slavic peoples were used as plantation slaves in the Mediterranean world.
India and China, most of the population were peasant laborers in debt bondage to landlords that tied them to a particular landowner as tightly as any slave in the American South was tied to a plantation owner. In Russia, most people were serfs. In the Americas, there were millions of African slaves, slaves of African descent, who of course in some parts of the Americas, especially in the West Indies and on the coast of Brazil, outnumbered white people. In Africa itself, most of the societies in Africa south of the Sahara were slave societies. There was an equally vigorous slave trade from the east coast of Africa to the Arab and Islamic world that went on for many more centuries than the trade from the west coast of Africa. So, most people in the world felt that these institutions of servitude, slavery, serfdom of one kind or another, were normal.
In many cases, the life of a slave in Africa was comparable to the life of a serf in Europe, much more than it was comparable to the life of an enslaved person in the Americas.
Many of the records of those who have visited Fouta Djallon during the time of Abdurrahman, before his time and afterwards, as late as 1821, record that slaves in that society generally live in independent quarters. They will have their own homes. A part of the day was designated for their own labor, so they will work perhaps for the capturing people for during the morning. Then after noon, they will work for themselves. So they had a large degree of independence, and an outsider might not even recognize them as slaves.
The punishments were not as cruel, the type of labor was not as hard. There was a lot of enslavement within the family, where the generation after, you know, the generation that was born in the family was considered up to a certain extent as part of the family and had some kind of kinship with it. So there was a possibility to become an elite, what was called an elite slave. People who gained power, including people who became kings, who had been enslaved before. So it was a different system.
This North Atlantic slave trade, which has been bolstered by two factors, racism on the one hand, in that Africans exclusively are being brought into this trade, and capitalism on the other hand, distorted and made slavery something qualitatively different and exponentially more brutal than that was what was known in African societies.
The slave trade was a very important part of the British economy. British ships at this time, the late 18th century, carried about half the slaves that were taken across the Atlantic. And in fact, after Britain and France went to war in the 1790s, Britain grabbed an even larger share of the trade, and by 1800, British ships were carrying 50,000 slaves a year across the ocean.
There was an economic need, and the economic need in this case was you needed lots of labor to make these plantations work.
planters in the West Indies felt, as they put it at the time, it was cheaper to buy than to breed. This was a business. It was a very well-established business. It underlay much of the British economy. It underlay all kinds of cultural institutions. The library at All Souls College, Oxford, was built with the profits from a slave plantation in Barbados. Portman Square in London was one of the capital's most exclusive addresses. Six of the 13 families who had mansions there made their money from slave plantations in the West Indies. There was no thought that these slaves were human beings. So this was cargo. You start thinking of people as cargo, as units, then they're not human. When you decide somebody is not fully human, whether it's a passenger on a slave ship or an inmate of a concentration camp or a prisoner somewhere who's being mistreated, then there are no limits. And then terrible things happen to people.
Like other West Africans who survived the Middle Passage, Muslims arrived on the auction blocks stripped of everything but their language, customs, and beliefs. Even these were too provocative for slaveholders impatient to control the new arrivals.
Come on!
The shaving of the hair, the removal of clothing, inspection of the teeth, all of that was a part of the dehumanizing process associated with slavery. It was part of the process that demonstrably communicated to all involved, but in particular to the person who was being enslaved, that they were moving from one status to another. They were moving from a status of being free to one of being enslaved. They were moving from a status of being a person to becoming a non-entity.
Their bodies no longer their own, even their names stripped away. Africans were forced to adjust to new working and living conditions, to adopt different customs, and to learn a language completely foreign to them.
And there was this deliberate attempt to prevent any kind of lingua franca developing among them. So slaves who were able to understand one another would be separated from one another.
Muslims posed a special concern, particularly as they were often better educated than the slaveholders who controlled them.
Many of them were literate, so they could write notes in Arabic and pass them around. So they were dangerous people in that way.
They posed a threat for that reason. Because of their organization skills and the fact that many of them were incensed at the idea of being enslaved by Christians.
In fact, Arabic was used by African Muslims to plot revolts in other slave strongholds in the Americas, from Baiano's uprising in Panama in 1552 to a series of rebellions in Bahia, Brazil, that lasted until 1835. When news of these uprisings spread, reading and writing, the cornerstone of Muslim life, were forbidden. So were schools, and on many farms and plantations, even religious worship. Most enslaved Muslims found ways of appearing to conform, which still preserved their dignity. And for a time, Islam survived, mostly in secret.
Writing in the sand, for example, was one way. There were even instances where writing materials, pens, slates that were very wooden slates that were very popular in West Africa were known to have been brought in and even made by some slaves.
You find attempts to preserve some of their culture while being innovative in creating new cultural forms that will create some kind of unity and solidarity among themselves.
We have evidence there were Quran schools set up amongst the slaves that people were teaching. There were people that taught in secret. This was happening.
And some slave owners took advantage of the fact that some of their enslaved people were Muslims. The fact that some of them could read and write. We've seen examples of men who kept the books of the plantations in Arabic, and let's put them in charge of the others. So slave owners had kind of an ambiguous relation to Muslims. They were feared, but at the same time, in other circumstances, they were used.
Once it was discovered that such people were literate, okay, it really tended to change the dynamic. It tended to change how they were viewed in slave societies.
Alam ayohalahu al-habib al-kari al-habib.
Show me what you just read.
Alam ayohalahu.
I know many languages.
The literacy and mores inherent to Islamic life did enable some Muslims to improve their standing within the plantation system. Some were even allowed to practice their faith openly, but they remained enslaved. A few, like Abdul Rahman, managed to gain their freedom, but even they remained bereft of any broader community of fellow Muslims.
The Muslims who came here were not able to preserve their religion in the form of institutions, beliefs, or writing.
And in fact, Islam eventually died out amongst the African population after slavery ended, when there weren't new Muslims coming from Africa to replenish the community.
Some 12 million African people were enslaved in the Americas. As many as 30% of them are thought to have been Muslim. Research continues to uncover their lives and discover their legacy that grew with the New World.
Because of what's going on today, there is an interest and a better knowledge, and that Muslims have been in the United States for hundreds of years.
I feel obligated to that history because I believe Abdul Rahman wanted to share that same story. Within it, there's a theme of love, there's a theme of diversity, and it's also the theme that shows the painful past that cannot be erased, but we can look back at it and still become stronger. Because I feel when you have a good sense of who you are able to move forward in a world where you keep your head high up. And that's the theme that I want to take from the story of Abdul Rahman.
Islam is part and parcel with American history. And that has to be understood by the American people, that this is this Judeo-Christian Islamic civilization.
While Europe was in its dark ages, great civilizations developed in West Africa. Inventive, sophisticated nations that were both politically and economically astute. At the time of his birth, Abdulrahman's beloved Fouta Djallon rivaled any kingdom in its intellectual and spiritual development.
The Fulbes, they love learning. They take pride in intellectual prowess.
The early Fulbe settlements lay along major trade routes in the lush highlands of what is now Guinea, more than 4,000 feet above the headwaters of the Niger, Gambia, and Senegal rivers. This fertile region attracted travelers from across Africa, who in turn left their mark on the local people.
The Arabs, because they were nomadic people, they were always venturing out. So by the 10th century, you begin to get these movements into West Africa of merchants, people looking for places to make money. Wherever Islam went, it's always had this attraction to local people.
For a time, Islamic culture flourished peaceably alongside indigenous beliefs.
What would account for such a rapid spread of Islam in West Africa is that these were tribal communities. So if one person became Muslim, oftentimes if it was the tribal chieftain, for instance, the whole tribe would become Muslim.
The devout who came in the late 17th and early 18th century were more organized and committed to bringing non-believers into the community of the faithful. Those who resisted, mostly animists, were increasingly unwelcomed in Fouta Djallon, and many migrated away. Finally, in 1725, Muslims founded the theocratic empire of Fouta Djallon. It would rise to be one of the great kingdoms of West Africa, like Djenné and Timbuktu, under an elected sovereign and eight Almami who governed its nine provinces. Timbo became its political capital for the next 170 years. Nous sommes arrivés à Timbo par une rue bordée. We arrived at Timbo and entered the city on the banana trees lined avenue. The rain surprised us at the very moment when the inhabitants were gathered at the mosques. Gaspard Théodore Molien, 1818.
Timbo was at the foot of a mountain. It was a village of perhaps 5 or 6,000 people. The houses were mud wall, conical, with sloping roofs. Almost every house had a courtyard. And usually the courtyards were surrounded with hedges so that people walking the streets and cul-de-sacs could mind their own business when they went by.
Les hommes sont beaux, forts. They are handsome men, strong and brave. They are intelligent. They are mysterious and prudent. Antoine Golbery, West Africa, 1787.
The Fulbe of Fouta Djallon placed great emphasis on a couple of things. One was a great care of their hands, The other was their hair, which they wore long in braids, often down onto their shoulders.
So that was their status symbol. And it's like a three-piece suit or bow tie, you know, today in America for an official ceremony. That was their dress code.
Les gens sont riches. Toutes les femmes ont des... The inhabitants are wealthy. All the women have silver jewelry, large golden earrings, and they wear togas in blue tie-dye. All signs of luxury among Africans. Gaspard Théodore Molien, West Africa, 1818. Beyond wealth and attractiveness, Les Fouta Djallon's most precious asset, this was a nation deeply rooted in spiritual and intellectual pursuits.
This was a theocentric or theocratic society. Power rested with Allah. The chief, the temporal chief, was just an instrument of God.
And I think that Islam amongst the Fobi was very important in giving them a very unique identity and reinforcing certain aspects of their personality as a proud people, even amongst other West African Muslim tribe.
Fouta Djallon scholars wrote the only version of the Quran in Pular, the local language, while other indigenous literature developed using the Arabic alphabet. There were schools in almost every town, and the kingdom became a magnet of learning for nations in West Africa. Education was Abdul Rahman's birthright.
Because he was the son of a nobleman, it would have been absolutely necessary for him to be not only literate, but erudite. And so he becomes a student of knowledge.
Islam is a very literacy-based tradition. There's a lot of learning that has to happen. One has to be taught the Arabic rudiments of Arabic, to know the prayer and to learn to recite the Quran and to be conversant with the literature, the sources of the religion.
At age 12, he was sent, his father, noticing his aptitude for this, decided to send him to the large cities of the East so that he could continue his education. This meant traveling about 1,000 miles down the Niger River to the city of Jenna, which was an ancient sub-Saharan town, a market town of great consequence and a center of Islamic learning.
We would consider it the Harvard of West Africa. This is where you went to sit with the cream of the crop. Those scholars would have held their ground in any intellectual circle in the Muslim world.
Abdurrahman was a contemporary of Tierno Muhammadu Samba Mombeya, who is the Shakespeare of Fouta Djallon. He may have known the powerful verses and poems of Tierno Samba, written in Pular, but entirely embedded in Islam. And it begins like this. Ya jom nanugol, hedo ha la gorel, jayingel loungel si afa la malal, iungel esa idu muhammaduel, selenke lenyol fu tanke laral.
Africa did produce men of learning. Africa did produce civilized, highly civilized individuals and societies. Africa did produce men of dignity and principle. And I think this is one of the very powerful points that the life and times of Abdurrahman Ibrahim drives home for us.
stacked like cords of firewood inside the ship's dark hold, Abdulrahman and 170 other slaves crossed 3,000 miles of ocean before he was sold again and carried across the Gulf of Mexico and up the Mississippi River to the Spanish port of Natchez.
The nature of how he came to be in that circumstance is so violent and ugly and unnecessary that alone can discourage the strongest of personalities. In spite of an identity or a value that someone else is trying to assign to you, if that's not who you are, then just don't subscribe to it. Don't be it. Be who you really are. And fortunate enough for himself and for all of us, I mean, he had a very clear sense of that. It's a great story. It's a story that I wanted to learn more about, to be able to just tell my friends and family and close relations. If this is like known, why isn't it known more?
Purchases freedom.
It's bittersweet. It's bittersweet, but he carried himself in a way that was dictated by his value of himself, not the value that was being put on him.
6 years passed, and though no one,
you know, it becomes a part of my story to be involved and tell his story, which is, mashallah, that's great. It's a blessing.